Dr. Sophie Messager, and this is the Wisdom Messenger podcast. In this show, I interview pioneers in women's health and personal development about groundbreaking concepts that help women reclaim lost knowledge and restore inner wisdom. By bridging insights from ancient traditions and modern research, we question stale cultural narratives and midwife a new paradigm around birth, life transitions, and women's autonomy. Join me as we delve into stories and studies that empower women to reconnect with their inner voice and live their truth. Tune in as we rediscover what it means to fully trust ourselves and shape our collective future. In this episode, I interview Naomi Tolson. Naomi is a microdosing coach, psychedelic guide, advocate, and community science researcher. She specializes in supporting parents who choose to microdose during their pregnancy and postpartum journey. Join us as we discuss how microdosing can support the pregnancy, birth, and postpartum journey. You'll hear about Naomi's experience of discovering microdosing and how it led her to stop attending birth as a doula, the benefits of microdosing, debunking myths, and how microdosing can help heal birth trauma. So welcome to this episode of The Wisdom Messenger, and in keeping with the theme of this first season of the podcast, where I want to discuss altered states of consciousness in the context of pregnancy, birth, beyond, I am delighted to have my guest today, Naomi Tolson, who is someone who used to be a doula and has now reconverted herself in being a microdosing coach. So would you like to introduce yourself, Naomi?
Yeah, thank you, Sophie. Yeah, so I'm Naomi, and after some years of being a birth and postnatal doula, I now find myself supporting, I still consider myself a doula actually, but doulaing those who are in altered states of consciousness outside of childbirth. Mainly I trained with the Microdosing Institute in Amsterdam as a microdosing coach. And so I run programs for people who wish to microdose for various reasons. I also am a mum to three boys who I home educate, and I live in Brighton with my boys and my husband, Aidan.
Lovely. I was just wondering, Naomi, maybe we should have a very quick overview of what microdosing is, because I think there might be people listening to this. For you and I, it's like, yeah, microdosing, but people might not actually know. So can you give us a very quick definition of what this is?
Yeah, sure. So microdosing is taking a very small amount, normally of a psychedelic. And in my case, I work with psilocybin or magic mushrooms, as they're more commonly known as. And we're talking about tiny amounts, like a 10th to a 20th of a recreational dose. And you don't experience any hallucinogenic effects when you microdose. So many people come to microdosing because they've heard it can help them with anxiety and depression, and a whole host. There's a whole host of other benefits coming out which microdosing can really help with. But yeah, I specifically work with psilocybin, but you can microdose many other substances. The most well-known ones are like LSD, you can microdose cannabis, even things like cacao. Yeah, many, many things, but my focus is on the mushrooms.
Great, thank you. So I'd love to hear what was the turning point, you know, what was the turning point sort of experience that led to your reconversion from birth doula to microdosing doula?
Yeah, well, it's quite a story and been quite a journey, actually. But I think I got to a point at the end of 2020 where I have this memory of sitting in a waiting room just outside of labor ward. And my client was in labor, and she'd gone into theater, and I wasn't allowed to be with her. and she was going down this into this cascade of interventions. And I just, it's such a moment that stays in my mind, because I just felt completely broken and helpless. And I just remember thinking, I don't know how much I can do this anymore. And really, over the next few months, I spiraled into this anxiety that seemed to come from nowhere. And, you know, it was really bad. And I started microdosing myself, really not very well. I didn't know what I was doing. There wasn't much information out there. At times it made my anxiety worse. I wasn't aware of how to take the medicine, or, you know, I was just totally guessing it. And it sort of ended up that I wanted to take a sabbatical. And luckily my husband was able to take a sabbatical from his work, and we pulled the children out of school. They were in mainstream school at that time. And we went to Costa Rica. And in Costa Rica, we went and we lived in an eco-spiritual community on the West Coast in a place called Pachamama. And it was really here that I learned more about how to microdose in a much more intentional way. But really what blew my mind and opened my eyes to a new way of working was the women that I met in this community who were pregnant and who were newly postpartum. They were all microdosing, and they were microdosing psilocybin, but also ayahuasca, which, for those people who don't know, is a brew made up of certain vines from the Amazon, and it's extremely psychedelic and hallucinogenic. And they were taking, you know, really small amounts of this. And what I really noticed was how completely different this experience was for them, this pregnancy and parenthood journey was, and how, you know, compared to my clients and people that I knew in the UK, where I felt like we were prepping soldiers for war to go and give birth, you know, and the hours upon hours I spent, you know, trying to teach people how to navigate the system and know their rights, and just so many hours doing that, and just, you know, really hoping for the best on the day. And here in this community were women who were really, there was none of that, because they all birthed in the community. So essentially home birth, there were doulas and midwives who came to support them, but there was no, you know, endless tests and, you know, scaremongering, or it was just all ceremony and ritual, and it was a joyous time. And they were using the medicine, so I'm calling the microdosing, the ayahuasca and the mushrooms, as medicine, but they were microdosing and also taking higher doses actually, but using it as a tool for spiritual growth and for transformation, and just connecting with their babies and with themselves. And they just had these incredible pregnancies, and you know, and postpartum as well, microdosing and being in a community of people who really understood. And it was just such a way of life. And I remember thinking, when we were coming back to the UK, I just don't think I'm going to be able to work as a doula in the same way, having seen this whole other paradigm. And I wasn't really sure how that was going to look for me, but I'd done a lot of self-development work there myself, and I had taken part in ceremonies with mushrooms at Pachamama myself. And I just really had this strong belief and knowing that this was going to be how I was going to work. I was going to work with mushrooms, and it was somehow going to tie in with the birth world still. And so really that was the start of, you know, my journey to where I am now. And when I came back to the UK, I signed up to train with the Microdosing Institute, who are based in Amsterdam. It was mainly online. I did go out there a few times. Yeah, it's been a year of just it's just been a fantastic experience. I feel so supported in the process. I feel like I've learned so much about myself, but also made some amazing connections with some really important people in the microdosing space. And I just feel so aligned to this path. And I think, you know, it was really timely as well, because I think a lot more people, it just seems to have happened at a time when now people are really hearing about microdosing. You know, it's in the mainstream media. It's being talked about on daytime TV shows. Apparently, I mean, I don't watch sort of mainstream TV, but, people who I would consider perhaps wouldn't know about microdosing have. And so it all seems, you know, the synchronicities I'm experiencing and have experienced just confirm to me that this is a really worthwhile path that I'm on, and I feel very aligned to it. Mm-hmm. But it's definitely been a huge journey with huge highs and huge, huge lows. And I'm not the same person I was at the end of 2020, as many of us are not, after going through such a, testing time. But yeah, this is where I have landed.
Wonderful. You know, as I was listening to you, Naomi, I remembered that I was the doula to a woman who was doing a PhD in anthropology in 2020. And she told me it's very common, that's what your experience reminded me of, that students in anthropology who end up going to visit hunter-gatherer tribes, you know, populations around the world, she says they often completely change their view of birth, because when they witness what you describe, I was immediately thinking of that. You can't, it's like taking the red pill, you can't unsee what you've seen, because what you describe to me as someone who also worked as a doula, someone who's also given up for pretty much the same reason that you describe, because of the fighting, then I can really resonate a lot to what you're describing. You know, you go to this experience, you have had this experience where you saw such a contrasting model of care and being that you can't come back to the system and pretend that it's business as normal.
You're so right. It is like, you know, taking the red pill. And I just knew I wouldn't. I mean, I did actually attend a couple more births because I'd already committed to some clients. It was two, I think, and both were free births. So actually I had a really beautiful, both were amazing, beautiful births, and it felt fitting that then I was finishing. You know, some people said to me, oh, you know, now, you know, you've had these two amazing births and you've attended these two amazing births, does it make you want to stay? And I was just like, no, I it doesn't actually. I just feel so grateful and thankful that that was my last experience in witnessing birth. And now I just feel so ready to move on. And also I felt, you know, I know that I did make a difference to a lot of people, even if their births did end up, you know, in the system and being sabotaged. But, you know, I was constantly tearing myself apart about what I could have said different. You know, what was the missing piece of information that I needed to have given my client in order for her to have escaped the cascade of interventions? I was always searching for that magic thing that was going to save people from their own experiences. And actually went through such a journey with that as well, realizing that I'm not here to save people from their experiences. And actually, you know, that isn't my responsibility. But also I feel that what I'm doing now and what I'm offering now is where the real change can happen, because I feel that the system isn't broken, the maternity system I'm talking about, it's designed that way. And the only way that it's going to be different is if the people who are giving birth stop sort of going to, or using the system, or start doing work that enables them to move away from that mainstream thinking. And what I feel like that's where what I'm going to offer and what I am offering is a chance to do the inner work, so that people can be in radical responsibility, that they can be, they get a chance to be autonomous and confident in themselves and their decisions. And for some, that is going into the system and it is what it is. Mm. But I feel like that's where I can make the biggest change and the biggest difference, is working with women in that way, not by witnessing their trauma in hospital. Mm. Because it traumatized me as well. Yeah. I did so much work about on my own trauma of witnessing trauma. It was, it, you know, it was really, really profound and traumatic. I was really, really traumatized by it.
Yeah, I get that. I think sometimes students are more traumatized even than the family they support.
Yeah.
Because of,
yeah, because when you're seeing the same thing.
And also the families often buy into the...
Mm.
Tell of, you know, the system saved me. Although the system caused the intervention and the cascade and stuff. And you know, again, what you're describing, it wasn't for me until I stepped out of birth delaying for nearly a year when I started to really understand that exactly like you say, change is not going to come from inside. The fighting against the system is not a good use of my time or energy. And therefore, you know, finding a completely new way of doing things. It's not going against it, it's going around it, it's doing something else completely different.
Yeah.
And I'm seeing a lot of signs of that. You know,
yeah.
My husband is from Hong Kong and he says, it's a very Taoist thing to say. He says, when you push the pendulum too far one way, it always comes back the other way. And I really, really like that expression.
Yeah.
It gives me trust and it gives me... So, you know, I want to ask you, like, so in, I'm going to go, and I've got a whole bunch of questions I'd like to ask you about, you know, working around birth. But first of all, you know, what's the biggest myth? What's, when you start working with people around this, what are the beliefs that people have? In fact, not just people you work with, in general speaking, what do you encounter? People have like myths, beliefs around the idea of doing microdosing work?
A few, really. I think the biggest one is that they think that the microdosing is going to cure them of something, that they're just going to take the microdosing capsule or however they take it, and you know, they'll just keep taking it and they'll just be cured. And it works in such a different way, because in our, you know, in our society, we're so used to allopathic medicine where we're taking a tablet, you know, normally, you know, every day for a period of time, and we don't have to do anything else. We just have to take the tablet and then, you know, that's it. But the thing that makes microdosing different is that, you know, like if we look at antidepressants, for example, they tend to suppress emotion. And so you're sort of held at a certain mood level and you can't really experience anything above it or below it. And you're just kept at that level. But the way that microdosing mushroom works is that they can actually amplify your emotions. Mm. So, what that means is that you have to do the inner work in order for it to be effective. And so that's why when I was microdosing in the beginning and not really understanding about it, it was actually making my anxiety worse, because it was bringing stuff up, but I wasn't then using that as a way to really tap into what was going on for me. I was just like spiraling even further. So I think people are sometimes disappointed when I tell them, you know, this is a journey and you have to commit and do the work. I mean, you don't have to, but if you want to really get the results that you're after, because a lot of people, you know, they usually come to microdosing because there's something that's out of alignment in their life. Mm-hmm. And it's usually something like depression or anxiety or, you know, it's a tool in helping you understand yourself better and finding ways in which you can heal yourself. You know, you have all the answers within you. But the microdosing as well, the amazing thing about it is it just, because it is an altered state of consciousness, even when you're taking tiny amounts, because people sort of generally think of altered states of consciousness as being only with the big experiences, you know, when you have the huge psychedelic journeys, etc. But no, microdosing does alter your state of consciousness, and it enables your new neural pathways, you know, what we call neuroplasticity, that, you know, different parts of the brain can communicate, and you have this greater awareness and observation of your own mind and thoughts and yourself that you wouldn't normally have access to. And so it's much easier to do the work because you have more insight into yourself. But, you know, you need to have things alongside the microdosing, you know, especially if you're dealing with difficult emotions, whether that's like therapy or, you know, somatic therapy, breath work, meditation, energetic work, whatever, you know, whatever it is. But, you know, people think, oh, there's this amazing new thing that you can take, you know, these mushrooms that you can microdose and I'm going to be cured of my depression. And it's obviously, you know, it's never as simple as that. So I would say that's the number one myth. And then also another one is that people do think you're going to have a mini psychedelic experience. You know, they think they're going to take a small amount and they're going to be seeing, you know, weird and wacky things. And do they have to stay at home all day when they take their dose? And people don't realize that you take it and you can go to work, you can drive your car, you can look after your children, you know, you can participate in everyday life and not be incapacitated by it in any way. And if you are, then it's too high a dose. But yeah, I would say those two things are probably the biggest myths that people come to me and have this idea about.
So tell me more about the whole supporting, and in fact I'd like to hear about the science of that, you know, supporting, because it's a very controversial subject, supporting microdosing through the pregnancy, birth and postpartum journey. You know, that I want to just tell for reference and comparison, I just want to highlight the fact that it's a paradox of our culture is that it's okay for you to have morphine injected to you during labor. That's because it's medically ratified. It's okay to you to have very high dose of injected morphine during labor, but it's not okay for you to have like some psychedelic doses of tiny amount or something, like it's seen as, because it's illegal, because it's you know, seen as dangerous. And like basically we live in a culture where anything that's outside of what's given by a medic, when about coming back to the antidepressant stuff you were talking about, you know, there are many side effects to taking, for instance, antidepressants, and many side effects to having morphine during labor, but that's not considered a problem because somehow it's part of the system, you know, just like to make another side note, we know from all the research on all the drugs that the most dangerous drugs of all is alcohol by a mile. But if we want to look at Professor David Nutt's report in London, you know, there's published research on that. But so it's just important to say that the container we live in is like, if it's not coming from the official dealer, which is a doctor, then it's dangerous. So tell me more about this, maybe in several topics, you know, how do you see, you've already touched on that, but how do you see supporting women, you know, through the pregnancy, in birth and postpartum, through the birth journey, through with this, and then talking about the research that's being done.
Well, the, you know, many women that I am supporting with microdosing throughout their pregnancies and in the postpartum, and when I say in the postpartum, generally we're talking about women who are breastfeeding, is normally these women are coming to me because they've been microdosing prior to falling pregnant. And they know how beneficial it is for them. Some of them have used microdosing as a tool for keeping their mental health okay, etc. And then they fall pregnant. And even when you look at, you know, microdosing organizations, all of them say do not microdose whilst pregnant, because in our society, you know, it is a taboo thing to, you know, for pregnant women to, it's like, you know, research is never done on pregnant women. So it's considered unethical. And so in terms of legalities, a lot of these organizations have to say not recommended. But actually, you know, I'm sort of going into the research side of it now, but you know, we know that mushrooms have extremely low toxicity. And especially when you look at other medications that are given to women in pregnancy and birth, like you were saying, we give women in birth heroin, which, and you know, there's been a study by Michelle O'Don who said women who receive heroin in birth, I think their children have a much higher incidence of addiction later in life. And that's never mentioned. We know it has low toxicity. We know that it does cross the placenta. Mm-hmm. And we know that it does go into the breast milk, but we are talking about absolutely minute amounts. And also, you know, there are some theories out there. I don't know if you're familiar with the stoned ape theory, which was a McKenna theory that, you know, we had this huge leap in evolution in our human story. And there's lots of sort of ideas around why this happened, why our brains suddenly developed so much in a relatively short amount of time. And there is this theory that, you know, the more ape-like humans were ingesting mushrooms, and it was creating this neuroplasticity in the brain, and therefore we were leaping forward in our evolution. But, you know, there's also the theory that actually it was the pregnant ape-like humans who were ingesting and passing this psilocybin through to their growing babies, who with, you know, neurogenesis and their developing brains, that was the leap in evolution. And then they were breastfeeding the babies with taking the mushrooms, etc. So there is, you know, and also indigenous communities have been, you know, dosing in pregnancy and postpartum for millennia. Mm. So we have that theory and this information in indigenous cultures. And we also have thousands of women through James Fadiman, who is a psychiatrist who is in America. He was at Harvard University with Ram Dass. And he started the citizen science research into microdosing in the 70s. And he has collected thousands and thousands of anecdotal reports. And actually he is a kind of friend of the Microdosing Institute, and he taught a couple of the workshops that I went to on my course. And I brought up the subject of pregnant women and women postpartum microdosing. And he absolutely was an advocate for it. And so we connected, and also with a woman called Michaela De La Maico, who is a woman, first generation indigenous woman who lives in San Diego in America, who is a huge name in the kind of psychedelic parenthood space. And the three of us have got together and we've created this survey. We've got hundreds of responses, but we're basically collecting the stories of women who are microdosing in pregnancy and in postpartum, and asking what their experience was, and also, you know, the experience of the child when the child is born and as they're growing up, and overwhelmingly positive stories. I haven't actually waded through all of them. I'm nearing 300 now, because it's quite detailed, but I think there's only been two stories that have been, I didn't really notice a difference, didn't really notice any change. All pretty much all the other stories have been changed my life, you know, for the better. My child was exceeding all milestones, you know, really seems to be, from an anecdotal perspective, a huge benefit. And the benefit as well, like the women that I'm coaching, who generally are microdosing already, and then they're going to microdose anyway in pregnancy. And my view on it is like coming from a perspective of helping them find a really safe way to continue and an intentional way. And, you know, using what I saw when I was in Costa Rica on how to really use it as a spiritual tool and as a tool to really be connected to themselves and their babies. And yeah, it's just incredible to be able to facilitate that and to see it. And, you know, especially I think in postpartum, and I think this is where I see the biggest benefit, because, you know, we know that so many women suffer with postpartum depression, and we know that so many women suffer because of birth trauma. And that's just totally not, you know, ignored by the mainstream. And really, I've devised a program where we really look at birth trauma and use the microdosing together with that, and seems to make a huge difference to women's experiences postpartum, and also connecting women going through the same things and experiencing microdosing in community. And supporting each other, and having, you know, really being able to feel supported by the medicine also. Yeah, it's just been incredible. And when you also think about how, you know, suicide is one of the biggest killers of women in the first year postpartum. And, you know, the more and more research coming out around SSRIs, that they don't really help depression in the majority of people. And also that we're so isolated. We're getting more and more isolated, aren't we, in our communities. And I just feel like this is such a beautiful way to hold and support women during this time, on so many levels. So I feel really passionate about it. It's obviously a really tricky thing because in the UK, it isn't legal. Mm. But, you know, in a lot of places, it is. It is, you know, in the Netherlands, in Portugal, many states in America. Australia has just legalized psilocybin and MDMA for therapeutic use. You know, we're so behind in the UK, which is utterly ridiculous because we're at the forefront of the research. You know, Imperial College London has done fantastic work with psilocybin and shown, you know, the results they've had with treatment-resistant depression and PTSD. Psilocybin has blown any other medication out of the water, and yet it's still not legal. And it's actually criminal that these people are keeping this medicine from people who really need it. And that's also kind of another side that I'm passionate about, as you can tell. part of an organization called Global, who are trying to they write to the Home Office, you know, they get people to write to their local MPs to try and get this medicine authorized and given to the people who really need it. And I feel really, really passionate about that. So, yeah, that's my,
again, I'm going to make a parallel, Naomi. We both know that it's not evidence that makes the maternity guidelines, you know, we know so many examples of things in maternity care that are not evidence-based. And actually, when evidence have shown, like, for instance, giving birth at home is as safe with a much lower risk of intervention, there's more than 10 years of evidence of that. And has it changed? Has it, you know? It's like when the birth place study came out and I thought, oh, we're going to see a rise in home births and a rise in births under birth. And did it happen? No, the exact opposite happened. So things don't happen in a vacuum. And when you start, that's what you described happened to you in Costa Rica and what happened to me when I stepped out of birth. Like, I'm still in the field, but I'm not at the coal face, so to speak. When you're not at the coal face, you step out and you look at the whole thing and you're like, wow. And people are unconscious of that. You know, there's a really interesting article that was written in, I think, 2001 or something like that, or 2010, by a guy called Marston Wagner, who was a very lovely, holistic medical guy, and he was responsible for women's health in the WHO. And the article is about maternity care in Australia, and it was called "Fish Can't See Water: The Need to Rehumanize Childbirth." And this article is, I can't remember, 20 years old or something, and it's still so current. But not only that, things have actually got steadily worse since.
It really has got worse, which is mind-blowing. But
Because
I think psilocybin will be authorized for therapeutic use in the UK, but it's just when will that be, and how many people have to suffer until it is that, despite all the evidence, and there are so many parallels with this, with the maternity system, as you say. So many women are suffering at the hands of this system that isn't designed for women, and it's very frustrating, especially like us who feel so passionate about these things, to be, witnessing the harm that it does, and somewhat were powerless. And now I feel like, we're stepping into our own power by working in this way, because we're not complicit in this, we're not, because I think sometimes as birth workers, we can become sometimes another cog in, cog in the wheel, and it's just like we're sort of fighting against it, but in some ways we're complicit with it as well. And the way that I feel I'm working, and I see you working too, is we're not in it at all anymore. We're really working outside of that paradigm, and it feels good to be doing that. It feels, that if we're going to make a change, I really feel it's going to be from outside. Like you say, it's never going to work. You're never going to be able to change the system from the inside.
I want to come back to something you said earlier, where you said you were preparing people for battle. The sentence that I used for years for my in my head is lamb to slaughter. When I meet pregnant women, I ran a women's circle 2 weeks ago in Cambridge, and this very heavily pregnant woman came, 8 months pregnant. And I asked her before the circle started, have you done any form of antenatal education? And she said no. And every time people say that, my heart just drop. I don't know what to say because there's no time, that's not the right context. But I have kind of supported several people through birthing from afar this year because you can't. When friends and people contact you, you can't. I still do ad hoc stuff with people because I can't let people I know personally go into that blindly. Just can't. But at least I'm not in the inside. But I'm able to like try, but to empower them. But it's very hard to help. That's why the sort of inner work that you describe. It's about people relearning to listen to their to their own wisdom. That's what it's about, so that they can approach whatever's being offered to them from a place of power. But I want to go back to the sort of research thing for a bit and ask you. I know I'm aware there's a lot of research on like psychedelic dose of psilocybin, but there's not. Is there any research on microdosing that's been published at this moment in time, or is it still very early days?
It's still early days. I mean, the major I think there are a few studies. It's interesting as well, talking about the research, because, like when I first got into doulaing, I spent many hours, looking at the research and really wanting to know all that. And actually, through this process, we were definitely did a lot of deep dives into the scientific research through the Microdosing Institute, but I'm less interested in it now. Like, I just feel like, it's like in birth, we rely on all this external validation of what's going on inside our own bodies. and, you know, like all the tests and all the things that you have to tell you what's going on. And then we see it in birth, don't we? Women always know. I mean, 99% of the time, how everyone's heard a story of a woman saying something's wrong, something's not right, and they were dismissed by the system and something wasn't right. Or women saying, I know I'm going to have this baby right now. And midwives like, no, you've got hours. And then suddenly the baby's there. Like, women know. And I feel like the microdosing is about tuning in and into your own body and hearing your own wisdom, as you said, and whether it's like the science is just catching up to that. It's like constantly catching up. And so I feel actually less interested in the science, you know. It's fascinating turnaround for me. And so I know there are a couple of studies. I prefer the citizen science. I love like reading the anecdotal stories of people who are it's real. It's like people's stories of their experiences of microdosing in real life, not just statistics. And also, you know, so many of these studies, they're not mushrooms. They're isolating the psilocybin molecule and making it in a laboratory and giving it to people. And when you think about, you know, how successful those studies have been in showing alleviation of depressive symptoms, etc., and that's only one part of the mushroom. And we know that the synergy between all the components of the mushroom, and you know, thinking about mushrooms that have been connected to the mycelium network, and you know, mushrooms that have been grown, you know, and loved and tended to by the people consuming them, you know, that is so much more powerful than an isolated psilocybin molecule in a tablet. And yet, imagine the results, you know, even huger than just what we know already. And so I think that's another side of it. It's just like, once again, you know, science is kind of trying to put it in a box and just take it down to one thing. And we know it doesn't, it's not about that. It's much more holistic than that. It's about the interactions between the mushrooms and the environment and you. And yeah, it misses the point, a lot of the research. And also it's interesting because James Fadiman, he talks about this in a YouTube video about, you know, how actually they did a science experiment and they were looking for certain factors in the experiment, and they didn't see any of those factors. So they concluded that microdosing didn't work, but they weren't looking for the right things.
I know the video you're talking about when he says that how people concluded because they only looked at such a way, like you made that gesture. That's what it feels to me, that the difference between plants, which are a whole thing, you know, plants in general, including mushrooms and lots of other things, and then when you isolate, which is what Western medicine does, you know, medicinal chemistry, which is only about 200 years old, does isolate the thing and then only looks at that, and then it becomes the experience of people taking the drug, which is the case, for instance, for antidepressant versus something like St. John's wort, which is a plant version of it. It works on the same principle as SSRI, is often a very different experience. Because I believe that energetically you've got the thing in the box versus a multi-layered, multi-molecular, energetic, you know, very different experience. And yeah, I completely agree with what you're saying. And you know, I'm also always been, as a, somebody who was a scientist for 20 years, extremely frustrated by the fact that we live in a culture that lack of scientific publication is automatically interpreted as lack of effectiveness of the, it's not true because it's not been published. It's just been looked at, like, but also, as you say, like the experience of people is discounted because it's not had within the box. And I you know, I have read some of James Fadiman's work and listened to some of it podcast, and if anybody listening to this episode today wants to look him up. There's loads of podcasts about him on YouTube and Spotify, and he's a really nice guy. In fact, is there any like Netflix series with him? I can't remember. I know there's, if people want to watch stuff, there's How to Change Your Mind on Netflix. And what are the other ones?
Fantastic Fungi. He's not, I don't think he is actually on.
No, I think David Nutt from London is in some of the series. There's the third
magic,
one. There's
a third magic, one. Magic Medicine, I think it's called.
Yeah.
I always forget that one, but that's about the Imperial College London studies with Robin Carhart-Harris.
But it's interesting, isn't it? Because we're still in a world where I, despite myself, go, oh yeah, James Fenimore is a scientist, Professor David Nutt is a scientist, but that's a world we live in. You know, as you know, my journey is to use drumming as a way to change states of consciousness, and as this we're recording this episode, I have an article coming out in a scientific journal literally like in a few days, and I'm very grateful for the editor of this journal to have asked me to write this, because suddenly it's going to give it validation. But I feel this mix of irritation and delight about it, because I think it should not be necessary, and yet this is a world we live in. And
exactly.
I often use my science as a bridge to bring people across, and I find that I often use the science, you know, but science says, like the drumming, people go, oh, pseudoscience. You go, well, actually, the research shows, blah, blah, blah. And then you can let people have the experience. I think that lots of people, because that's a world we live in, would not even consider, because there would be a lot of fear.
Yeah.
You know, consider taking microdosing. There's going to be fear about doing something where there would not be, because it's given to you by a doctor and therefore it's safe. So having the understanding of the fact that it's not just a weird thing that people in the rainforest do, you know, and that it's kind of gaining traction in it's I think it's at its place, whilst also being completely aware of the fact that it's not the be end and all, to have the narrow I can't find a word I'm looking for, you know, the narrow looking glass of the Western scientific world, going, well, it's not fitting in the box, because it's parallel with maternity care, is that right? Maternity care is about making women fit in a box, and often they don't, and then where do they go? Because you're either low risk or high risk. You're either, you know, like we have just want to quote that number, because we have some hospitals, and I got that number through somebody I did a podcast with, Erin Funk from Better Birth UK, who said she made a freedom of information request to her local hospital to ask how many first-time mothers were being induced in her hospital, and it's 47%.
Wow.
So the average rate of induction of labor is 35% across the UK right now, but that mixes second-time mother with first-time mother or third-time mother with, and so that really biases the data lower to what we actually see, which we're heading towards a first time mother induction rate of 50%. And we can't say that's based on logic or science.
No, I mean, from an evolutionary point of perspective, it cannot be possible that 50% of women are unable to
go into labor on their own.
Yeah, I mean, just it doesn't make any sense. And it doesn't make any difference to the rate. It hasn't brought down the stillbirth rate, so it's
clearly it's madness, you know, honestly it is. So it's really interesting to hold the two extremes together, the madness in what is seen as a logical, rational system, and the complete distrust of anything that changes your state of consciousness. Can you see the parallel between the two? Because we live in a culture that thinks you can either be rational, or, you know, with all the sort of idea of altered state of consciousness, or the fear of loss of control.
Yeah. And also, do you think it has something to do with, you know, I know that for many people who take psychedelics, etc., they often come out of that kind of mainstream thinking, and they start thinking outside the box, yeah, and sort of be having realizations around certain things. And I think, is there an agenda that, you know, that isn't what, you know, the people in power want? They don't want people experiencing altered states of consciousness and thinking for themselves and thinking outside the box and questioning the narratives. And I'm sure they'd all rather we were all on the same frequency, yeah, and just, you know, sort of in a trance, but
or
a trance.
Of,
yeah.
It's a form, yeah, of trance. You know, yeah, what I found really fascinating is that, sorry, I've kind of lost the train of thought here, but
being in a trance,
like, birth is a trance, yeah, right?
Yeah.
But so is being on your phone, you know. But coming back to the birth thing, birth, if it's allowed to unfold as nature intended, is a trance. There's an old, very deep altered state of consciousness. Anybody who has seen a woman in labor knows that there's a crossing the threshold where the woman goes into a different state. You know, I'm sure you've told that to partners so many times. I've said, you know when that's happened, because she won't be quite a normal chatty self. She will look like she's gone somewhere else. We,
yeah,
know that. There's interestingly very little research done on that. You know, like, people have not really studied what happened to the brain of women when they give birth. But I believe that when it's allowed to unfold like nature intended, it is meant to be an altered state of consciousness. And certainly my experience of giving birth for the first time was, for days I walked around feeling like I was a newborn. The world looked different, smelled different, that all of it felt really good. And then I went to a birth conference when my son was 4 months old, when I met Michel Audin, Ina Megaskin, and Frédéric Leboyer, and someone there said to me, look, Sophie, the society we live in doesn't want women to have experience like yours, because look at what they make to you. Because within a few weeks of giving birth, I was like, I want to change my career to go and help women have the experience I had. And
you are a really good example of why they don't want people to have.
Yeah. So for me, you know, it's, I'd like to hear what you think of that, but because the system doesn't allow women to experience a birth trance, I've come the last few days and I've been doing research for the book I'm writing on drumming and birth and women light transition, to think that actually it's not just that we're interfering with the birth process, we're actively preventing the trance. I don't think it's a conscious process. So in that respect, how do you, if you think about that, how does the altered state of consciousness that comes with what you offer fits into that?
Well, in terms of what I offer, I think, you know, what I offer for women who are pregnant, really, it's aimed at people who are not going to birth in the system.
Mm.
Because I think, like you say, even if it's not a conscious thing, it's, you know, even if you do the work and you are more connected to yourself and you have a better understanding of what's going on for you and you feel more connected to your baby, if you then enter the system, I don't know how much of a difference it would make, because there is this whole, you know, like you say, the whole setup of hospital and any kind of medical care, the constant interruptions, you know, the lights, the instruments, all of that brings you out of that altered state back into more into the neocortex, I guess,
yeah,
and
yeah,
into the thinking mode. So really what I'm offering is, I guess there's an element of being more comfortable about being in an altered state and having more trust in yourself and the process, because it's something you've already experienced in your pregnancy. And there's not so much fear around that going,
yeah,
into it. I think it is it's such a hugely fascinating topic, the altered states. And also it's really interesting because I've done some training with a company called SafeShore, who provide support to people who are having psychedelic crisis. So if you would imagine, you know, at a festival or an event that people are taking psychedelics and they have a bad experience, they have somewhere to go and there are people who are trained to support through the process. And when I was doing the training, we did a lot of role play. And what I really noticed was that when I was supporting someone who was in that altered state, it was exactly the same as supporting someone in birth. There was literally no difference. And afterwards, you know, it's just, it just really blew me away on how it was exactly the same. The tools I used, the skills, the way that person was, the environment, everything. Yeah, it was just really fascinating. So that's why I feel like I'm still a doula, because to me, it feels almost exactly the same, because it's all about working with altered states.
Yeah.
And it doesn't really matter per se how that's being achieved. It requires the same understanding of how it's come about. That understanding is not understood by, you know, because it was actually quite mind-blowing, the stories I was hearing from the guys running that course about how doctors treat people who are in psychedelic crisis. You know, no understanding of altered states or how to support someone through that. Again, very similar, you know, not, you know, calm environment, no bright lights, you know. But obviously when they go in, it's the bright lights, lots of people doing the tests, etc. So it's a really, really fascinating topic. And yeah, one that I don't think many people are talking about.
No. Well, that's really interesting. And I think I'd love to talk to you all day, but I think that's a really great way to end our discussion about this really fascinating topic. So Naomi, where can people find you if they want to get in touch with you after listening to this episode?
The best place is on my Instagram, which is the psychedelic doula. It's the_psychedelic_doula. Or they can look up my website, which is psychedelicdoula.co.uk.
Mm-hmm. Excellent.
Those are the two best.
I'm really grateful that you came. I will put links under this episode.
Thank you.
And I'm really grateful that you came to talk to me about this. I think that was really a fascinating discussion.
Thank you, Sophie. I really appreciate to be asked. And yeah, thank you.